मसल आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द मसल ऑफ द सुपरफिशियल बैक, मसल ऑफ द बैक सुपरफिशियल मसल। ऑल द मसल ऑफ सुपरफिशियल लेयर आर कनेक्टेड विद द अपर एक्सट्रीमिटी एंड आर फॉर्मड बाय टू मसल सब लेयर। द मसल ऑफ द सुपरफिशियल सब लेयर आर कंसर्न विद द शोल्डर रीजन एंड द अपर एक्सट्रीमिटीज, वेयर द मसल ऑफ द डीप सब लेयर आर कंसर्न विद द शोल्डर रीजन ओनली। आई वुड लाइक टू रिपीट अगेन, आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द मसल ऑफ अपर सुपीरियर बैक रीजन, क्लियर। एंड ऑल द मसल ऑफ सुपरफिशियल लेयर आर कंसर्न विद द अपर एक्सट्रीमिटीज एंड फॉर्म्ड बाय टू सब लेयर्स। वन मसल सुपरफिशियल लेयर आर कंसर्न विद द शोल्डर रीजन एंड द अपर एक्सट्रीमिटी, शोल्डर रीजन एंड अपर एक्सट्रीमिटीज, वेयर एज द मसल ऑफ डीप सब लेयर आर कंसर्न विद द शोल्डर रीजन ओनली। इट कैन बी डिवाइडेड इनटू टू लेयर, वन इज सुपरफिशियल लेयर मसल एंड डीप सब लेयर मसल। नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द सुपरफिशियल लेयर मसल। द सुपरफिशियल लेयर ऑफ मसल इज डिवाइडेड इनटू टू लेयर्स। फर्स्ट इज ट्रेपेजियस मसल, द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट मसल फॉर फिजियोथेरेपिस्ट एज वेल एज फिजिकल एजुकेटर। व्हाट इज ट्रेपेजियस मसल एंड फ्रॉम वेयर इट ओरिजिनेट? एज यू कैन सी इन द डायग्राम, इट इज द अपर बैक मसल, इट इज द मसल ऑफ अपर बैक डॉर्सल रीजन एज वेल एज नेक रीजन। यू कैन सी दैट फाइबर, रेड फाइबर्स आर डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिंग ओवर द डॉर्सल रीजन, ओवर द स्कैपुलर रीजन, ओवर द नेक रीजन। So the descending part of trapezius muscle arises from the medial third of superficial nuchal line of occipital bone. It means it originated from the nuchal line of occipital bone. First, from the external occipital protuberance of the occipital bone as well as the ligamentum nuci. This is the ligamentum nuci. All the muscle, trapezius muscle, are originating from the just beside the SCM, sternocleidomastoid muscle. This is the sternocleidomastoid muscle, but these muscles are the some of the fiber of trapezius muscle. So some of the fiber of trapezius muscle are originated from the your occipital bone. So second origin, which is attached to the spinous process and to the interspinous ligament of the upper six cervical vertebrae. It means this muscle has origin from occipital bone over the spinous process, and it is having always, it also it is having attachment over the ligament. See here, the spacing muscle, it is having attachment over skull, having attachment over spinous process as well as ligament. What is ligament? Ligament is a structure which connect one bone to other bone. So this muscle is having direct control over your spinous process or vertebral column as well as indirect column. Normally muscle is known as dynamic stabilizer. They mainly provide dynamic stability to our joint, as well as ligament and bony configuration is known as static stabilizer, clear. But this muscle, as we can see here, this muscle is originating from bone itself as well as it is having some attachment over ligament. So this muscle is having full control over static posture as well as dynamic posture. The transverse part of trapezius muscle arises through a flattened tendon from the spinous process of seven cervical vertebra and upper three thoracic vertebra. The ascending part of trapezius muscle arises from the spinous process of rest of vertebra. It means, as we can see here, it is originating from all thoracic vertebras, cervical vertebras, occiput, and having, clear, it has a multiple origin. This muscle has a origin from ligamentum nuci, it has origin from over occipital bone, it has origin over the dorsal spine, it has origin over the intraspinous processes. So it has multiple origin. Now come to the insertion of this muscle. The descending part of trapezius muscle is inserted onto the posterior border of acromial end of clavicle. See here, origin, it has a multiple origin, it has a multiple origin, but the descending part after descending mean which is coming down from, it has two origin. Some fiber are originating from down to and going up, some fiber which are originating from the cervical spine and ligamentum nuci as well as your occiput, they are coming down. So it is two ended muscle, one fiber end is coming from up to down, some fiber are going from down to up, clear. So the descending part, the fiber, muscle fiber which are coming from up to down they are inserted onto the posterior border of acromial end of clavicle. Posterior border of acromial end of clavicle. Acromion process mean the here. Posterior, posterior means back. End of acromion process of clavicle over the tip of fibula. So muscles which are coming from up, they are attaching here. Clear? One sum of fiber of trapezius are originating from here and attaching here. It means when they contract, they will produce this type of movement. Clear? Next, the insertion of transverse part of trapezius muscle is located further laterally on the same end of clavicle and is stretched as far as the acromion. The other part you can see, some fibers are coming from up to down, some fiber are down to up, but laterally. They are also attaching over the clavicle. Down to up, they are attaching over clavicle. So when they contract, they will produce shoulder retraction. Clear? First part of trapezius, they are coming from up to down. They are attaching over acromion process. So whenever they will contract, they will produce this type of movement. The second, flat end, flat mean flat fibers. They are running from down and going to attach over the tip of acromion. So whenever they will contract, you can see in the diagram, when they will contract, they will bring your scapula towards your dorsal spine. So it can cause retraction of your shoulder girdle. The ascending part of trapezius muscle ends at the triangular tendon, which is inserted onto the lower border of spine of the scapula. Lower border of spine of, this is the spine of scapula. This is the spine of lower body, spine of scapula. So the lower fiber which is going up, they are going to insert over here. Mostly fibers are inserted over tip of acromion, tip of acromion process of clavicle, tip of acromion process of clavicle, and other are going to lower border of spine. Clear? So they have mainly three fibers: ascending fiber, descending fiber, and flat fibers. Ascending and flat are inserted over the tip of acromion, so they can produce. I will discuss the movement. And third is going parallelly and attaching over the lower end of spinous process of scapula, tip of the scapula. Now come to the innervation of trapezius muscle. Innervation of trapezius muscle. The trapezius muscle is innervated from the external branch of 11th cervical nerve, the accessory nerve, and from the direct branch of cervical plexus from the C2 to C4 segment. It means this muscle is also having multiple innervation. And whenever we are seeing, even in sports or in normal sitting posture, everyone comes to with neck pain, and when you palpate his trapezius, it is having always tender point. Whenever you touch here, patient will have a bouncy effect. It is because of such heavy innervation of this muscle. Clear? By having a number of innervation in that muscle, it is displaying all the signal, all minute to minute signal to center, and we will perceive. What is pain? Pain is perception. So whenever it, because it is having maximum number of sensor, so it will send all information immediately and more precisely. So we can feel more pain whenever we will have any type of pathology in this muscle. Now come to the description of this muscle. I will love it because it is bigger muscle, has three origin and three different insertion, had different function. So I would like to describe the some of important feature of this muscle. The trapezius muscle is big, flat, and triangular muscle. As you can see in the diagram, big, flat, triangular. One angle at the occipital region, other is tip of acromion, and third at here. You can see on both sides it is making a triangular structure. Up, down, yeah. This is a triangular both sides. So it is a big, flat, and triangular muscle. Its lower part partly covers the latissimus dorsi muscle, where it lies directly under the skin. Latissimus dorsi is also very important muscle, originate from your pelvic bone and inserted over the upper arm, longest muscle, climbing muscle. So its position with reference to L dorsi, its lower part partly covers the L dorsi muscle, where it lies directly under the skin. In this position, one can easily palpate the trapezius muscle over the skin. It is divided into superior part or descending part. फर्स्ट पार्ट, सुपीरियर पार्ट, डिसेंडिंग पार्ट, ए मिडिल पार्ट और ट्रांसवर्स पार्ट, एंड इंफीरियर पार्ट और असेंडिंग पार्ट. ऑल दीज थ्री पार्ट्स एंड ऑन द शोल्डर रीजन. एज वी हैव सीन, इट हैज मल्टीपल ओरिजिन फ्रॉम डिफरेंट रीजन ऑफ स्कल, वर्टेब्रल स्पाइन, डोर्सल स्पाइन. इट मीन इट इज हैविंग थ्री पार्ट, बट वी कैन सी हेयर ओरिजिन इज एट मल्टीपल लेवल, बट ऑल द फाइबर्स आर गोइंग टू इंसर्टेड समवेयर नियर द स्कैपुला, समवेयर ओवर द एक्रोमियन और इधर ओवर द एक्रोमियन प्रोसेस और लोअर बॉर्डर ऑफ और लोअर बॉर्डर ऑफ स्पाइन ऑफ इंफीरियर एंगल ऑफ स्कैपुला. क्लियर? नाउ कम टू द फंक्शन, फंक्शन ऑफ दिस मसल. दिस इज बिग मसल, फ्लैट मसल, हैविंग हाई इनर्वेशन एंड मेन मसल विच इज कंट्रोलिंग द मोबिलिटी ऑफ योर नेक. इट हैज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल इन द कंट्रोल ऑफ योर नेक एंड हेड, एंड हेड इज द बॉस ऑफ होल बॉडी, कंट्रोलिंग सिस्टम ऑफ होल बॉडी. इफ एनी वन विल नॉट हैव कंट्रोल ओवर योर हिज हेड, इवन ए फुटबॉल प्लेयर, वेन एवर ही इज हिट हैव सम इंजरी, ही गेट फेंट. वाई हीज फेंट? बिकॉज ही डोंट हैव कंट्रोल ओवर हिज हेड. सो फॉर एनी स्पोर्ट और एनी थिंग, एनी फंक्शन, द हेड कंट्रोल इज मस्ट. And your trapezius muscle is playing a very important role in head control. And this is the muscle we have seen in the description. This is the muscle which is having highly innervation, which is having highly origin. It is connecting two bony ends from different regions. So it will have control over different bones. It will have mobility over different bone. So this is a muscle of great importance. Now come to the function of trapezius muscle. As we have seen, it has three types of fiber. Different, they have different origin and direction of fiber running is different. One is coming from up to down, one is coming from in the same parallel line, other is coming from going from down to up. So they will have different function. The first and most important function, the muscle fiber of upper part of trapezius muscle elevate the shoulder joint with vertebral column acting as a fixed point. Suppose when your vertebral column from axial skeleton is fixed, when your axial skeleton, suppose if this is a axial skeleton and if it is a fixed, like it is a head, it is your head, suppose it is a head, when it is fixed and you are moving your shoulder, so in this movement overhead, if your shoulder is moving up and down, this trapezius ascending fiber, descending fiber will be helpful in elevating the shoulder joint, elevating the scapula over towards your head. So with the head fixed or vertebral column fixed, this descending fiber will be helpful in elevating the shoulder joint. But the muscle fiber of transverse part, this is the function of descending fiber. Descending fiber mainly elevate your shoulder or scapula when your axial skeleton is fixed. But when your shoulder is fixed, so in that condition, this fiber will be helpful in the side flexion of neck toward the side of muscle fiber. The muscle fiber of transverse part, the second part, transverse fibers, you can see here, these are the transverse fiber. They are mainly responsible for the muscle fiber pull the shoulder, pull the shoulder joint posteriorly. They pull the shoulder joint posteriorly. You can see here, whenever they will contact, the transverse fiber will contract, they will pull the shoulder joint posteriorly. This is known as retraction of shoulder joint. So the transverse fiber are responsible for protection of shoulder joint. And the third muscle fiber, they are ascending up. The ascending part of muscle depress the shoulder joint, depress the shoulder joint. When they will contract, they will bring the scapula down, because we can see in the diagram, fibers are originating from the dorsal spine and inserted over the inferior angle of spine of scapula. When it will contract, it will bring scapula down. So we have seen the three different function of three muscle fiber. Upper fiber or descending fiber causes two function, one with scapula fixed causes side flexion of neck, with your head fixed causes elevation of shoulder. Second, your transverse fiber are responsible for retraction of shoulder. Third, ascending fibers are responsible for bringing down your scapula. Now, in the other condition, when with the shoulder joint is fixed. When your shoulder joint is fixed, mean appendicular skeleton is fixed, the contraction of ascending part of trapezius muscle alone one side with tilting of head to the opposite. Whenever your shoulder joint fixed, the contraction of one side of trapezius will cause tilting. Tilting mean side flexion. Tilting mean side flexion. Though the symmetrical when you use produce contraction at one side, but when you produce bilateral movement mean your neck is coming in extension. So whenever you will produce single side contraction, it can cause side flexion of your head over your shoulder. But when you contract bilateral trapezius through the asymmetrical contraction of ascending part of trapezius muscle on both side will extend the head. It will cause extension of head. When your descending muscle, which is coming from up to down, when bilateral it will contract, it will cause extension of head. So I would like to repeat again function of all fibers. First, take example, suppose your scapula is fixed. Sorry, your axial skeleton is fixed. Whenever your axial skeleton is fixed, and it means you are producing mobility over your shoulder and scapula. So descending fiber will cause elevation of shoulder. Your transverse fiber will cause retraction. Your ascending fiber will cause depression of shoulder. And the next condition, when your scapula is fixed, you are producing movement over your axial skeleton. So descending fiber, if you contract one side or unilateral side of muscle, it will cause side flexion. But if you contract bilateral muscle, it can cause extension at the neck. Contraction of transverse part of the ascending part of trapezius muscle on both sides extend the trunk and helps to stick out the chest. Clear? When you contract this part, it will cause extension movement over the spine. Clear? So it has multiple function. I will start it. Side flexion is the function of unilateral contraction of trapezius muscle. Extension of neck is a function of bilateral symmetry contraction. Elevation of shoulder as well as detraction of shoulder, these functions can be performed by the trapezius muscle. So as we have seen, most of the neck and shoulder joint movement is controlled by these three fiber of trapezius. So we can imagine how much this muscle is important. And upper extremity dynamic as well as static control is must for any sports or ADL. So we can know the importance of trapezius muscle. Thank you. Discuss is latissimus dorsi muscle. The latissimus dorsi muscle arises from a wide aponeurosis thoracolumbar fascia. What is aponeurosis? Aponeurosis means a bundle of muscle. A bundle of muscle originate from thoracolumbar fascia, from the spinous process of lower six thoracic vertebra, from the spinous process of all vertebra, from the intermediate sacral crest of sacrum, and from the posterior third of iliac crest of hip bone. As we can see here, this muscle has a multiple origin. I would like to repeat it again. The latissimus dorsi muscle arises from a wide aponeurosis. It means a group of bundles of muscle are originating thoracolumbar fascia from the spinous thoracolumbar fascia. Thorax and lumbar muscle. Thorax and lumbar muscle are covered in a fascia is known as thoracolumbar fascia, from the spinous process of lower six thoracic vertebra. Lower six thoracic vertebra mean we have 12 thoracic vertebra. So if we leave first six, so it means from seventh फ्रॉम एट थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा, फ्रॉम नाइन थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा, फ्रॉम टेन थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा, फ्रॉम इलेवन थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा एंड ट्वेल्व. सो लेटिसमस डॉर्साई ओरिजिनेट फ्रॉम थोरेसिक सेवन टू द थोरेसिक ट्वेल्व. इट ओरिजिनेट फ्रॉम द स्पाइनस प्रोसेस ऑफ टी सेवन टू टी ट्वेल्व, स्पाइनस प्रोसेस ऑफ थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा. एंड ऑल्सो द फाइबर, सम फाइबर्स आर ओरिजिनेट फ्रॉम द इंटरमीडिएट सैक्रल क्रस्ट ऑफ सैक्रम. इंटरमीडिएट सैक्रल क्रस्ट ऑफ द सैक्रम, यू कैन सी इन द डायग्राम. सम ऑफ फाइबर्स आर ऑल्सो ओरिजिनेटिंग फ्रॉम द इंटरमीडिएट सैक्रल क्रस्ट ऑफ सैक्रम एंड फ्रॉम द पोस्टीरियर थर्ड ऑफ इलियक क्रस्ट ऑफ द हिप बोन. इट मीन्स कि मोस्ट ऑफ द फाइबर्स आर ओरिजिनेटिंग फ्रॉम द टी सेवन टू टी ट्वेल्व स्पाइनस प्रोसेस एंड सैक्रम इंटरमीडिएट सैक्रल क्रस्ट ऑफ सैक्रम एज वेल एज पोस्टीरियर थर्ड ऑफ इलियम. इट मीन्स इट इज हैविंग फुल कंट्रोल और सम ऑफ द कंट्रोल ओवर द मोशन ऑफ इलियक बोन, ओवर द सैक्रल बोन एज वेल एज ओवर द डॉर्सल स्पाइन. Now come to the insertion of latissimus dorsi. The latissimus dorsi muscle runs laterally. Laterally mean कि they are originated from the either from sacrum, from ilium or over the spinous process of T7 to T12 dorsal spine. But they will run laterally. It mean they are originated from the midline of the body and going away from the body. So we will say the fibers are going laterally. Upward, they will go upward because they are originating from sacrum, ilium and T7 to T12. So the fiber will go upward and inserted with a flat tendon on the crest of lesser tubercle of the humerus. It means the muscle fibers are originating from T7 to T12, sacrum bone, ilium bone, it means pelvis. It means it is long muscle which connect your pelvis to pectoral, pelvis to your arm, shoulder. It means a muscle which is having some link between your arm muscle as well as hip muscle. So it is a long muscle and having insertion over the lesser tubercle of the humerus. Now come to the description of innervation of this muscle. This muscle, latissimus dorsi, is supplied by the thoracodorsal nerve from C6 to C8 segment. It means it is having innervation, sensory and motor innervation from thoracodorsal nerve, which root value is C6 to C8. Now come to the description about this muscle. The latissimus dorsi muscle lies deeper than the trapezius muscle, which partly covered. It means it is deep muscle of back. It is deep muscle of back which runs below or below your trapezius muscle. Now come to the function of latissimus dorsi muscle. With the origin of, we have seen the origin of L dorsi is basically from the spinous process of T7 to T12 thoracic vertebrae, from the sacrum, from the iliac crest. With the origin of latissimus muscle acting as a fixed point, so it will have two functions because it has a all those muscle which has attachment and insertion from appendicular bone to axial bone they can perform double function. In one manner, when one end is fixed, other end moving, they will perform in the other manner. On other way, when the appendicular end is fixed and axial end is moving, they can perform other function. So we will discuss the function of latissimus dorsi in both condition. The condition number one, when we will keep our axial skeleton fixed. It means there is no mobility over the pelvis or dorsal spine or lumbar spine. It means your axial skeleton is static. So we are going to produce movement over the other end of insertion. It means that is over the arm. So when your axial skeleton is fixed, the latissimus dorsi muscle results in adduction, retroversion and medial rotation of the arm. Adduction mean it is going because muscles are originating from the back and dorsal spine. and insert it over the lesser tubercle. So it will cause whenever it will contract, you can see in the diagram, contraction of this muscle will pull the humerus toward the midline of body. And second is medial rotation, because medial rotation means whenever it will bring arm toward the side, it will cause medial rotation of, as you can see, this is the, I can try to explain this thing. This is the humerus, this is the greater tubercle, and this is the lesser tubercle. Lesser tubercle is towards the head side, whereas GT is away from the head side. So whenever there is any contraction from this side to that side, it will cause bringing this medial tubercle towards the inside. And whenever your medial tubercle is coming, or lesser tubercle is coming towards the mid side of joint or gland cavity, is known as internal rotation or medial rotation. So whenever there is contraction in latissimus dorsi in fixed axial skeleton, it will cause adduction and medial rotation of the humerus. And the next condition, with the arm acting as a fixed, suppose when your arm is fixed and you are moving your axial skeleton, suppose your arm is not moving, there is no mobility at arm, in the next condition we can imagine we not producing any movement over the appendicular skeleton, we are going to produce mobility over the axial skeleton. So what is the function of latissimus dorsi muscle? With the arm acting as a fixed point, the latissimus dorsi muscle elevate the trunk and result in climbing movement, because we can see in the fibers are going from down to up. So whenever there is contraction, when you pull anything and try to go up, like this exercise, like pushing push up, in this muscle, when you are trying to go up, it is the main function of latissimus dorsi. So latissimus dorsi muscle is also known as climbing muscle by contraction of L dorsi in arm fixed position or closed pike position of arm. When your terminal end of arm is not able to move, it is fixed at one point, and when you produce contraction in the latissimus dorsi muscle, it will cause elevation of trunk upside. So this muscle is also known as climbing muscle. With the arm acting as a fixed point, the contraction of L dorsi muscle on one side will result in the rotation of trunk to opposite side. Suppose the other function of L dorsi, this climbing function is the contraction of bilateral muscle. The climbing function is the contraction of, is because of contraction of bilateral muscle. But what happens if we contract unilateral latissimus dorsi? Whenever we will contract unilateral latissimus dorsi, it will cause one side will result in the rotation of trunk to the opposite side. Suppose if your left side L dorsi will contract, it will cause rotation to the right side. If your left side unilateral latissimus dorsi will contract, it will cause rotation of trunk right side. If your right side L dorsi will contract, it will cause rotation to the left side. So I would like to summarize the function of latissimus dorsi. Latissimus dorsi has three important function. First function, because this muscle has attachment over the appendicular skeleton as well as axial skeleton. So whenever your axial skeleton is fixed, it will produce mobility over the appendicular skeleton, that is your arm. It can produce adduction movement and internal rotation movement over the arm. Whereas whenever your arm is fixed, it can produce ascending or elevation of trunk or climbing movement when it contract bilaterally. But whenever the L dorsi will contract unilaterally, it can cause rotation of opposite side. For example, if your left side L dorsi contract, it can cause rotation of right side, trunk rotation. When your right side L dorsi contract, it can cause rotation to the left side. When your left side L dorsi contract, it can cause rotation of right side. Thank you.
As we learned that kidneys are the major organs of excretion, but besides the function of excretion, kidneys also perform many other different functions. Like I said that in the process of excretion, apart from the kidney, many other organs are involved, like GIT, liver, lungs and skin. Now if we take GIT or digestive system, the main function of digestive system is to digest the food and to provide us the nutrition. But apart from this main function, digestive system also performs the function of excretion. Likewise, liver, where it plays many different functions, also plays an important role in excretion. Similarly, kidneys, though they are the major organs of excretion, they also perform many other functions. In fact, kidneys, apart from excretion, are very important regulatory organs. By regulation, we mean that they help in maintenance of homeostasis. As I said earlier, that homeostasis means maintaining of the internal balance or internal environment of the cells or the body. Now, in this internal environment, there are certain things that are to be maintained at a constant. For example, the content of the water inside the body, content of the electrolytes, for example, sodium, potassium, calcium, etc., pH of the body fluids, similarly, the pressure of the blood, which is called as blood pressure, and many other different things which include our internal environment. Now, maintenance of this environment, which is called as homeostasis, has to be maintained as a constant, and maintaining this constant is called regulation. This regulation function is performed by different organs, but kidneys are one of the important organs of regulation and play an important role in the maintenance of the homeostasis of the body. Now, the other functions which kidneys perform besides the excretory function are, number one, maintenance of the water balance. Our body, as I said earlier, has a limited water content, that which is approximately about 32 liters, in which this water is divided into certain compartments. These compartments are extracellular fluid and intracellular fluid. Extracellular fluid means the fluid or the water that is present outside the cells, and intracellular fluid means the water content that is present inside the cells. So, the total body water can be divided into two major components, intercellular fluid and extracellular fluid. Now, this extracellular fluid can further be divided into two different compartments. One is plasma, that's the fluid or the water that is present within our blood vessels, and the rest will be called as extracellular fluid. So, extracellular fluid has the two components, plasma and the fluid that is surrounding outside the cells and not in the blood vessels. Now, the balance of this fluid, the amount of water in the body, is very important. If the water content in our body increases, it will make our cells shrink. It will drain the electrolytes from our cells into the water by the process of diffusion, as I mentioned earlier. In this way, our cells may shrink. Likewise, if the water content outside the cells becomes low, it may make our cells swell. So, the maintenance of water balance is very important, and kidneys play a very important role in maintaining this water balance inside our body. Kidneys, as I said earlier, form the urine, and urine constitutes of water and the waste material. Kidneys have the capability to excrete the amount of water according to the need of the body. For example, if the water content inside our body crosses the normal limit, the kidneys will excrete more water into the urine, thus making the urine dilute. Likewise, if the water content inside our body decreases, the kidney stops or reduces the amount of water that is excreted to the outside through urine. In this way, kidneys, by making concentrated urine or diluted urine, can regulate the water balance inside the body. Here, an important hormone called antidiuretic hormone, which is secreted by the posterior pituitary, plays an important role. Whenever the water content inside our body is low, the antidiuretic hormone is secreted, which I said earlier, it increases the reabsorption of water from the kidneys, that is, from the distal convoluted tubule portion of the renal tubules. In this way, retaining the water inside the body and making a balance of the water content of the body. So, the important function, one of the important functions of the kidney, apart from excretion, is the water balance. Second important function in terms of regulation which kidneys perform is the maintenance of the electrolyte balance. There are many electrolytes present inside our blood and our body fluids, like sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarbonate, calcium, phosphates, and many other electrolytes. The concentration of these electrolytes inside the cell and outside the cell has to be maintained at a constant. And any variation in the concentration of these electrolytes can create a disturbance in our body. That means it will disturb the normal homeostasis of the body, which will ultimately lead to many types of diseases. For example, if the sodium content of our body falls too low, our body will not be able to retain the water. So, our body, apart from losing sodium, will also lose the water. In addition, sodium is very important for the function of many organs of our body, like heart. So, any disturbance in sodium balance will have its effects on the heart as well as on the whole of the body. Kidneys, by the process of reabsorption and tubular secretion, can maintain a balance of these electrolytes inside our body. For example, if the sodium levels in our blood, in our body, falls low, the kidneys will try to reabsorb more sodium from the urine and therefore will excrete less urine to the outside. Here again, the absorption of sodium, as I said earlier, takes place in all the three portions of the nephron tubules, that is, proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, and distal convoluted tubule. The reabsorption of sodium from the distal convoluted tubule is regulated by a hormone called aldosterone. This hormone is secreted by the adrenal cortex, which is a gland, endocrine gland, and this hormone increases the reabsorption of sodium from the kidney tubules. In this way, whenever there is low sodium in our body, our kidneys retain more sodium and therefore excrete less sodium into the urine. Likewise, if the concentration of the sodium increases in our body, kidneys will excrete more sodium into the urine. So, in this way, kidneys regulate the balance of many different electrolytes inside the body. So, these two functions, maintenance of water balance and maintenance of electrolyte balance, they both are regulated by the kidneys. In this way, we can say kidneys play a very important role in homeostasis, that is, in maintaining the internal environment of the cells. Another very important regulatory function of the kidney is maintenance of acid-base balance. Our blood and our body fluids have a very narrow range of pH, that is from 7.4 to 7.8. This pH, that means this concentration of hydrogen ions, pH means the concentration of hydrogen ions. And from the pH, we can say whether a solution or a fluid is acidic or basic. For example, if 7 is considered as a neutral pH, that means if the pH of a solution is 7, it means that it is neither acidic nor alkaline, it is neutral. And when the pH lowers, for example, pH from 6 downwards means acidic solution. 6 means slightly acidic, and as we go downwards, the acidity increases. For example, pH 1 means a solution is very strongly acidic. Likewise, when the pH increases, that means if the pH of any solution is above 7, it will be considered as alkaline. 8 pH means a solution is slightly alkaline. Similarly, as we go upwards from 8, 9, 10 and 12, the pH, the alkalinity of a solution increases. That means 9 pH means a strongly alkaline solution. Our body, as I said, has the pH of 7.4, which is the average pH. This means our body fluids and blood is slightly alkaline. And this pH is very important for the proper functioning of our body. Basically, the functions of our body, or the processes of our body, or the processes in our cells, many different processes, they are performed by various enzymes. Enzymes are basically substances that catalyze many different reactions. For example, we have discussed the metabolism, that is the process by which the body derives energy. Here, this metabolism involves many different processes, chemical reactions. And these chemical reactions are carried by the help of enzymes, which act as catalysts. Catalyst means a substance that increases the rate of reaction in the forward direction. So, in short, we can say that most of the functions of our body is carried out by the enzymes. And if the enzymes stop to work, our body will automatically stop to work, and this will lead to death. Our enzymes are very sensitive to many different things, and one of them is the pH. Our enzymes work at an optimum pH of 7.4. Any alteration in this pH, or in other words, any alteration in the concentration of hydrogen ions, will make the functioning of enzymes very difficult. They will automatically stop functioning if the pH goes more alkaline or goes lesser, that is, becomes more acidic. Now, the pH, as I said, is determined by the concentration of hydrogen ions. In this regard, kidneys help in maintaining this pH by excreting the hydrogen ions into the urine. Whenever the acidity of our body fluids increases, that means if the concentration of hydrogen ions by any cause increases in our body, then these extra hydrogen ions are excreted by the kidney to the outside, thus bringing the pH back to its normal. Now, kidneys can excrete the urine directly from the filtrate and also by the process of tubular secretion, which we discussed earlier. So, one of the most important functions of the kidneys is the maintenance of the pH of the body fluids, or we can say maintenance of the acid-base balance. Another important regulatory function of the kidneys is the regulation of blood pressure. Blood pressure can be defined as the pressure that is exerted by the blood on the vessel walls. As you know that in our body, the blood is contained into the blood vessels, both arteries and veins. And this blood, when moves into these vessels by the action, pumping action of the heart, this blood exerts a particular pressure on the vessel walls. This pressure is called as blood pressure. And we usually measure this blood pressure by the help of an instrument called sphygmomanometer. This blood pressure has a constant value in our body. The average blood pressure of our body is 120 mmHg, that is systolic pressure, and 80 mmHg, which is the diastolic pressure. Systolic blood pressure means when the heart contracts and pushes the blood into the vessels. At this time, the pressure in the vessels is high. This pressure is called the systolic pressure. But the next moment, when the heart relaxes, the pressure at that time lowers, and that pressure that is called as diastolic pressure. So in our blood vessels, there are two types of pressures. One is systolic pressure, another is diastolic pressure. Systolic pressure is when the heart contracts, and diastolic pressure when the heart is in relaxation state. Now, the maintenance of this pressure is very important, because unless and until this pressure is maintained at a constant range, at a particular range, our tissues will not be perfused properly. From the heart, the blood is taken out by the great big vessel, a large vessel called aorta. Inside this aorta, the pressure is, systolic pressure is 120 mmHg. Then this aorta further divides into large arteries which supply different organs. And these arteries further divide and subdivide, and at last these form the capillaries. So the pressure of the blood when it comes from the heart is high, and when it reaches the tissues through capillaries, the pressure is comparatively low. But the pressure that is in the capillaries, that, or in other words, inside the tissue, is very important for the perfusion. Perfusion means supplying the tissues with blood. If this pressure in the capillaries falls below the normal, the perfusion will not take place properly. That means the tissues will not be supplied with the proper amount of blood. And if the tissue does not get the proper amount of blood, they will not get the proper amount of oxygen, they will not get the proper amount of nutrients, which I said earlier that both the nutrients and the oxygen is very important for energy. And if the tissues does not get the energy, the tissues will stop functioning and performing their particular actions. So, a particular perfusion pressure is very important, which is dependent on the blood pressure of the body. If somehow the blood pressure lowers, that will also lower the perfusion pressure. In this way, the proper blood supply will not be maintained in the tissues. So, kidneys here also play a very important role in the maintenance of the blood pressure. Kidneys actually secrete a hormone called renin. This hormone, renin, is secreted by the kidneys whenever there is decrease in pressure, decrease in the blood pressure. This hormone, renin, goes into the blood and in turn activates a plasma protein called angiotensinogen. Angiotensinogen basically is a protein found in the plasma in our blood, but this angiotensinogen is in inactive form. That means this protein does not have any action. When the renin is secreted by the kidneys, it acts upon the angiotensinogen and converts into angiotensin 1. So whenever there is decrease in pressure, kidneys will secrete a hormone, renin, which will activate the plasma protein angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. This angiotensin 1 is further converted into angiotensin 2 by the help of an enzyme called angiotensin converting enzyme, or in short ACE. This angiotensin and converting enzyme is produced mainly by the lungs, and major conversion of this angiotensin 1 takes place in the lungs. Once this angiotensin 2 is formed, this angiotensin 2 is a strong vasoconstrictor. Vasoconstrictor means a substance that constricts our blood vessels. So when there is vasoconstriction, the pressure in the vessels will automatically increase. So in this way, kidneys maintain the blood pressure of the body by the help of a hormone, by secreting a hormone called renin, which acts upon a plasma protein, angiotensinogen, and makes it active and forms angiotensin 1. This angiotensin 1 is further converted into angiotensin 2, which takes place by the help of an enzyme, angiotensin converting enzymes produced by the lungs. This angiotensin 2 is a strong vasoconstrictor. It will cause constriction of the vessels and therefore will raise pressure back to the normal. So in this way, kidneys also regulate the blood pressure of the body and indirectly maintains the perfusion of the tissues. Another very important function of the kidneys is the homeopathic function. Homeopathic function means blood forming function. Our blood, as I said earlier, consists of two components, solid part and the fluid part. Solid part consists of the cells, RBCs, WBCs and platelets. And the fluid part, which is called as plasma, contains water, plasma proteins, electrolytes and many other organic substances. The blood forming is basically related to the formation of cells. Blood cells, that is RBCs, red blood cells, WBCs, white blood cells or leukocytes, platelets or thrombocytes. These cells are formed in the bone marrow present in our bones. Kidneys, by secreting a hormone called erythropoietin, this hormone acts on the bone marrow and therefore in this way increases the production of red blood cells or other blood cells. So kidneys also have another function, which is called as homeopoietic function. So kidneys also help in the formation of blood cells. Another function of the kidneys is the endocrine function. Endocrine, as I said earlier, is a system in our body which consists of many different glands, and these glands secrete substances called hormones. This system of glands and the hormones is called the endocrine system. Kidneys also have some endocrine function, though it's not an endocrine gland, but however secretes certain hormones, as one I mentioned earlier is the renin, which helps in the regulation of blood pressure. Another function which is related to the kidneys as a very important function is the activation of vitamin D. Vitamin D is a vitamin. In our body, we require many different vitamins. As you must have heard, vitamin A, B, C, D, E, and K. These vitamins are very important for many biological processes. Among them, vitamin D is very important for the absorption of calcium from the intestine. Absorption of the calcium that is present in our diet cannot be absorbed from the intestines unless we have an appropriate concentration of vitamin D. This vitamin D is basically and initially formed in our skin from a substance called cholesterol. Our skin has a subcutaneous layer which contains fats as well as cholesterol. When the sunlight falls on our skin, that is, or we can say UV rays, ultraviolet rays, because the sunlight contains ultraviolet light. So under the influence of ultraviolet light, our skin forms a precursor of vitamin D. So the vitamin D formed in the skin is not active. That means it has no physiological action. It cannot reabsorb the calcium unless it is activated. So the inactive form of vitamin D, which is formed in the skin by the action of UV rays present in the sunlight, is first activated in the liver and then by the kidneys. So kidneys perform the final step of the activation of vitamin D. And when the vitamin D is activated, it helps in reabsorption of calcium from the intestines. So we can say the kidneys indirectly play an important role in the calcium metabolism of the body. Because calcium, as you know, is very important and essential for our bones and teeth. Our bones and teeth are majorly formed by the calcium salts. So the calcium is very essential for our growth of bones as well as our teeth. And this calcium is derived from the diet. But without the help of vitamin D, this calcium of the diet cannot be reabsorbed from the GIT into the body. Here, kidneys in this way, by activating vitamin D, helps us to reabsorb the calcium from the intestines and therefore maintaining an appropriate level of calcium in the body and therefore helping the growth of both our bones and the teeth. Thus, we can say that kidneys, apart from performing the major function of excretion, it also performs major regulatory functions of the body. That is, it helps in maintaining the homeostasis by maintaining the water balance, maintaining the electrolyte balance, maintenance of acid-base balance, regulation of blood pressure, and by activation of vitamin D. Now, to summarize the excretory system, we can say that our cells and our body performs many different functions, and for these functions our body and cells need energy. This energy is derived from food when it combines with oxygen. Deriving this energy from food is called metabolism. During this process of metabolism, many waste products are produced. Also, many different toxic and waste substances also enter our body. So it becomes desirable and necessary that the waste products of the metabolism and other toxic substances that enter our body should be removed from the body. And removal of these substances from the body is called excretion. Now, many different organs play an important role in excretion of these substances. Among them are GIT, which excretes unwanted substances, food substances in the form of feces, skin, which excretes water and many other wastes, liver, which excretes bile pigments, heavy metals, drugs and toxins, and lungs, which excrete carbon dioxide. But the major excretory organs is the renal system, which constitute kidneys, ureters, urinary bladder and urethra. Renal system performs the function of excretion by the formation of urine. That means that the kidneys excrete the waste material into the urine and urine is excreted out. Urine formation takes place by three processes. First, filtration, that is filtering whole of the blood into the kidney, into the Bowman capsule, except the RBCs, WBCs, platelets and plasma proteins. From this filtration and this filtrate, the useful substances are reabsorbed back by the help of process called tubular reabsorption. And whatever is left inside this filtrate, which later forms the urine, are the unwanted substances. So the kidneys, by forming the urine, remove the unwanted substances from the body, and in this way play an important role in the excretion of waste substances from the body. Beside the excretion, kidneys also play an important role in the regulation of the homeostasis by regulating water balance, acid balance, electrolyte balance, calcium balance, and many other different functions. Thank you.